Today, we have Mr. Dante Campioni with us. Mr. Dante Campioni is the Chief Executive Officer, Managing Director, and Board Member of Alex Bank since 2015. Let me give you a little brief about Mr. Dante before we start our interview. Mr. Campioni brings with him strong commercial expertise gained from his diversified experience through different business units in the Intesa Sanpaolo Group, started in 1979. His extensive Italian and international business experience featured several assignments within the group, both in Italy and outside. Amongst the other, for about 4 years, he held the position of general manager at the Singapore branch of Sanpaolo IMI. He was head of Europe and Mediterranean area at the London hub of Sanpaolo IMI for about 6 years, head of corporate banking and international development in 2006-2007 at Banca IMI Milan, the group investments arm, head of business Mediocredito Italiano for more than 3 years. Previous to his assignment in Alex Bank for about 3 years, Campioni headed the Liguria and Southwest Piedmont region, one of the largest Italian areas within the ISP domestic network. Before Egypt, starting from Parma, his hometown, Campioni's global path included Amsterdam, Frankfurt, Singapore, and London, in addition to Milan, Turin, Rome, Florence, and Genoa in Italy. Mr. Dante, good afternoon.
Good afternoon to you.
I would like to thank you very much for joining us today, and I'm quite confident that this interview will be very beneficial, especially for the youth. Let me start with my first question. In addition to what I just said, how would you introduce yourself? Who is Dante Campioni?
Well, thank you for this introduction. And just to respond quickly to your question, Dante Campioni is a lucky guy because after this experience all around the world and Italy, he landed in what is definitely my last part of career, in a fantastic place that is called Egypt, in a fantastic bank that is called Alex Bank. And my last 5 years have been absolutely exciting. And since I know very well that I'm lucky, and since I am a passionate of Arabic calligraphy, I have a calligraphy in my office that says, I dare to pronounce in Arabic, so pardon me, but says, Wakun min el shakirin. So to be thankful, because really, I am very happy to be here. I joined the bank in 2015 in a moment that I think was very peculiar for Egypt. And I had the privilege to attend, for example, at the conference in Sharm el-Sheikh, where basically a huge amount of reform and new initiatives were launched. And basically, I could start working in an environment that is extremely exciting with a team that is really fantastic. I really believe that whatever we do is a collective achievement. And the spirit that there is in Egypt, the spirit that is in Alex Bank, I always say to my people that made me younger. So, so that's the reason why I consider myself a very lucky guy. And just to add something to the bio, you mentioned Mediocredito Italiano, that was I was head of business of here. Mediocredito Italiano is a specialized entity in SMEs. So basically, my experience in the retail, SMEs, even investment banking, I think is really something magic to make my contribution to Alex Bank as positive as possible. So basically, this is Dante Campioni.
Great. I think one of the most traditional questions that is being asked everywhere now is, how is the coronavirus is going to affect the industry which everybody is operating. In your point of view, how is the banking sector affected by the coronavirus?
Definitely, there are several impacts, because there are organizational impacts. For example, I am currently at home. We are applying already since mid-March smart working, and 80% of our people at quarter is working in this way. But of course, we had to take a lot of decision also regarding our branch network. In operational term, we had to experience so a new way to work. So a new research of efficiency and effectiveness under difficult circumstances. There is definitely an impact on our business, because we need to learn how to interact with our customers in a different way. What I see, because being part of an international group, we have a view also on what happened abroad. I would say that in Egypt, the behavior of customers, especially in the network, has not changed much, because in Europe, for example, we know that basically nobody is going anymore to a branch. Everybody is banking through digital connection. So in Egypt, it's not like that. So there is more continuity under this point of view. There are definitely, and this has to be assessed, the impact in terms of profitability, in terms of also because we need to assess the possible impact on the credit quality and the possible NPL formation. But from what I see and I hear, being let's say in contact, constant contact with the other reality of our group, so far I believe that Egypt is coping very well, and also thanks to decision that we have taken that, in my opinion, are quite effective. So definitely there is a strong impact, but I remain positive for the outlook of both the Egyptian economy and the impact on the Egyptian banking system.
Very good. How has Alex Bank dealt with this crisis?
Alex Bank has dealt swiftly, also because being part of an Italian group, and I think everybody knows that how unfortunately Italy was hit hard since the beginning. At group level, and we were asked to attend these meetings, immediately started action to be taken. I would say even in advance compared to the local market. For example, we created immediately a crisis committee where we discuss. We is in the ambit of the business continuity management, and this crisis governance committee basically divided the activity in three streams. One was monitoring and communication, both internal and external. The other was health and hygiene. Definitely, we had to intervene in a specific way. And another one was to mitigate the impact on the business. So there were three different streams that were activated. And basically, we put at first safety of our employees and our customers first. For example, Alex Bank, since March, started providing customers entering branches with masks. So not only employees, but also customers, in addition to sanitizer and so on and so on. So on. We apply definitely the smart working, as I said, social distancing. Also in the branches, we prepared a special solution to avoid that our branches could be crowded. We set up waiting areas outside. We let people entering. We double, for example, our security guard in order to have people caring about the social distancing of our customers. We have divided the teams of the head office in different teams, even the contact center. Basically, we have, let's say, break into two different locations. And within these two locations, each of them three different and completely segregated areas. So basically, it's like we have six different contact centers. Even organizing transportation in order to avoid this, that people that were segregated at work could meet during the transportation. So basically, this is what we did in order to let's say try to contain the crisis. Unfortunately, we had people that was anyway infected, and actually in the last period, I believe also due to the effect of the let's say celebration period and so on and so on. Likewise, the rest of the country, we have seen a number of cases that have increased within our in our bank. For sure, we had also people that is not with us anymore. So of course, my thoughts are first with these people, the family, and also to the people that currently are sick. Two of them are at the hospital in let's say serious conditions. So to them also our thought, our wish that they can get well soon, because this is definitely we are a proxy of the country. So we have between direct and indirect employees roughly 5,000 people. So all this drama that we can see around the country also is hitting also us. And our duty is to try to minimize as possible risks while assuring the maximum business continuity, because definitely we managed to keep running our service. And this goes to the merit of everybody, because the level of commitment that I see and the level, the sense of responsibility of everyone is really huge. So I think this is part of the generosity also of Egyptians. Egyptian is generous people. So I saw a difficult situation. We are experiencing a difficult situation. We have done whatever we could to face the situation, but I have seen also really how Egyptians are able to respond to any crisis. So this is also strengthened my ties with
this is very good. I'm happy that you touched this human side of the banking industry. And actually, this is my following question: how would you define leadership, and how would you define leadership specifically in such challenging times?
I came to Egypt with a strong view on leadership. I always applied a style of leadership that by chance I saw, let's say, well represented in a paper of the Harvard Business Review in 2009 that called this style of leadership communication. This style of leadership that I bring with myself is the leadership of not a superhero, but is something that has two sides: definitely individual leadership, but also collective citizenship. My style of leadership and what I try to transmit to my people is a style of leadership of someone that try to engage, to empower, to motivate its people. And leverage on the sense of responsibility of everyone. The point is that we are all equal. There is no one that is more important than the other. But we have different level of responsibilities. And the level of responsibilities means responsibilities, means that we share definitely successes, but also failure. Means that we don't kill for a mistake, but we analyze and we learn from our mistakes. What I tell my manager is that I don't care to know if something happened, who was. I want to know from you if you are sure you did what all you could to prevent this mistake happening. Because when there is a failure, we are all responsible, perhaps. Unless there is, of course, the voluntarily wrongdoing on someone. But in normal circumstances, so if something gets wrong, I am the first responsible, definitely. And then we will see what happened wrong. So I like to say to my people that Alex Bank is a 60 years old startup, because I like the spirit of the startup. I have been also a startupper, because before coming to Egypt, I launched a technological startup that then I had to abandon the idea because I moved. But I experienced the spirit of the startup. And the spirit of the startup is that this everybody feels that can contribute to something, feel part of the project. So the leadership must be inclusive, must empower, must leverage a bit on the sense of responsibility. In this way, and they see in this situation, how this is working well. Because even if the normal chain of communication are a bit disrupted and so on, everyone knows how to do, knows how to, and is responsible, and knows that can act without fearing to fail, because even if it's a failure, he will be not killed, because what I fear is that nothing happened wrong because nothing is done. I prefer to have things done responsibly. Then if there are some failures, we analyze, we prove, we decide. So, but so I also let my manager go through a specific formation in this sense, because I transmitted my wish, my ideas to a local training company, and we organize training and so on and so on. So I think that this is the style of leadership that I like. It's not the leadership of a superhero, is the leadership of the entire organization. We are all leaders. We are all leaders. I always tell my branch manager, you are 175 CEOs. I want you to feel like a CEO on your territory. So this is basically what I think.
This is very interesting. As I stated in the introduction I made a few minutes ago, you have served in various countries. Let me ask you, how is the Egyptian banking market is different?
The Egyptian market is different compared to other market I serve, because first of all is in a transition situation compared to other more mature markets where I have served. But the acceleration of the conversion that there is, the convergence that there is in the Egyptian market versus more mature market is incredible fast. So I see a market that has still to develop certain, but the progress are huge. If I think how was it the market in 2015, and now is a huge difference. I think, for example, iScore didn't exist basically. Now iScore is well established institution that support extremely well the banking activity, and I'm sure that there are other the other initiative that will be taken and making ASCOR even more central to the sector in the near future. Definitely there is a lot to do, because if we look at the ratio between GDP and loans, the ratio is extremely low. So if you look at the density of branches, it's extremely low. So it's a market where we have to invest, and definitely we can see the fruit of our efforts. And we can do this avoiding the mistakes that have been done in the markets, because if you look at Europe, there was an overinvestment, for example, in branch network. And banks spend huge amount of money to create a very dense network. And now they're spending money to slash this network. So we are also in a situation where we can assure this market growth, taking full advantage of the new technology, the digital services, so on and so on. So we can assure a growth that is absolutely beneficial for all the actors in the field, for all the stakeholders, for customers and for banks. So I see also that the importance and the contribution that the banking sector, also for the very strong leadership decided by the central bank, the impact on the real economy is huge, much more red than other market. And I think that if from one side this responsabilizes even more, because we know that the impact can be huge and we need to do it in a proper way, but the other end also give a lot of satisfaction to us, because we know that what we do has a real impact. And so we can get a great satisfaction from our job. And what is good, and what makes my stay in Alex Bank so nice also, is because that, you know, Alex Bank is part of the Intesa San Paolo group. I am coming from the San Paolo side. San Paolo was a bank that was born in 1563 in Turin, and was a charity foundation. And even after the merger with Intesa, we maintain this strong social concept. We know that what we do is important, can be important in terms of social impact. So our current CEO has worked a lot to affirm Intesa San Paolo Group as a champion for sustainability and for social responsibility, and we do this in Alex Bank, because this is also the way we have to do, and all the banks, the entire sector in Egypt is doing to support the Egyptian economy. So that's the reason why also make me very happy to work in this market.
Great. Talking about the Egyptian economy, given the uncertainty that is taking place around now, do you believe that the Egyptian economy, including the financial industry, is able to cope with the uncertainty of this period?
Well, definitely. I mean, just start from the banking sector. I think the banking sector is very solid, is well capitalized, extremely liquid. The loan to deposit ratio is very low, so definitely banks, apart the fact that they have to keep managing well their resources, but banks under the strong leadership of the central bank, I think can cope pretty well with this situation. So I already said I'm very optimistic and so on. Regarding the industrial sector, I believe that there is a huge chance, because I think that we all are aware of the fact that we need to decrease our import. There is a huge huge chance that local companies, local manufacturers can substitute import. So I think that there are several sectors that can contribute. And this is sustained by also, for example, the now huge amount of infrastructure that we created in the last few years. If we think about, for example, the availability of energy for the industry is totally different from 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. If we think about availability of electricity, gas availability, so also the outlook of the country, thanks to the discovery of a new gas field has changed completely. So energy is not anymore a problem. I think that Egypt has potentially a very good skilled manpower. So there is a huge chance. Definitely, there are some reforms that have been done. Other reforms that I understand are underway to support the private sector, because definitely in the last period the public sector has let's say supported a lot the growth of the economy, but public sector alone cannot let's say assure the rhythm of growth that a country of 100 million people like Egypt should achieve and can afford. So we need that the private sector can invest. Definitely the authority are working to facilitate this process. So for example, when I said measure that have been taken by the authority to cope with the situation, I mean the 8% loan scheme introduced by the central bank now basically is available almost for any kind of industry. And we are talking about 8%, while a few months ago the interest rate this company had to pay was almost double. The cost of energy has been decreased because it has been decided by the authority to decrease the cost of the energy for companies, for enterprises. So there are all the elements. I hope to see, let's say, more investments, and I hope that to see that the private sector can reach the confidence to mobilize investment. I think also that there is a need for entrepreneurs to be more open to the market. I hope to see, for example, more companies going for listing. As Alex Bank, for example, we have signed agreements with private equity companies to, let's say, support the growth of SMEs, wishing them to list, and the listing could be the way out for the private equity company. So I really hope, and there is the chance that Egypt can take this opportunity that are given also by a clear role that, in my opinion, Egypt has, and I'm referring to the free trade area that is about to be launched in July in Africa, and definitely Egypt can be the gateway between Europe and Africa. And really, Egypt would be a place for foreign companies also to come to invest and penetrate the African market from Egypt. It doesn't mean relocation, no. I mean optimization of production, because there may be components that can still come from Europe to Egypt, but also there may be product that from or component from Egypt to go to Europe in order for this company to optimize their production, but with the aim to grow their business because they open up to market. These are the African market that everybody think that Africa will be a fast growing area in the world in the next 10 years. So I think this is a great opportunity, so I believe that there is a great chance for Egyptian entrepreneur to take on this role.
You have mentioned a couple of times the SMEs and the startups. Actually, I'd like to build on this. What are the main changes required in perspective and culture of dealing with SMEs and MSMEs? What do you think about that?
I think that we need some changes on both sides. I think that, and let me start from the banks, because we need to establish a better level of trust between banks and SMEs. How banks can gain the trust of SMEs? First of all, banks need to be quicker in giving and clearer in giving the answer. For example, we have developed automated workflows to route the request of SMEs. We have created also rule-based concession systems that can cut dramatically the time to yes for SMEs. We have cut also the amount of documents and collateral that normally we ask, or normally banks are used to ask, in order to show SMEs that the bank is a friend, is a partner, and is asking you what is needed. And I would say that we have not completely deployed yet these tools, because there is the last mile to have a completely automated end-to-end process. But we have achieved great progress, and we are growing in the SMEs from the microfinance to the medium enterprises at very strong pace. And I am quite pleased that we manage even to achieve the target of 20% that was asked by the central bank by the end of last year. So, and this testify our commitment. But on the other side, we need that also the SMEs, in general company, but especially SMEs, learn that they have to guarantee more transparency. We need to have access to reliable information. They need to be open to share information, because really, in order to affirm a real partnership, we need that both sides actually operate like partners. And in this sense, I believe there are also solutions that in other countries have been taken that could be beneficial, in my opinion, also in Egypt. For example, I always refer when the chance I have the chance to refer the example of Hungary, where, for example, it has been created a public repository of balance sheet, certified balance sheet, that are loaded by the company or the auditors in electronic format, that based on the need and the approval of the customer for bank to acquire their balance sheet, this can be taken even in electronic format. So this could be immediately used to the automated process that we can, so basically in 2 hours to get immediately an internal rating of this company based on the Amazon. So I think that this is something that should be also considered in Egypt. And I believe that I mentioned, for example, iScore could be, for example, the repository of this balance sheet. So this is something that could help in speeding up, because speed is important with SMEs. If an SME come to a bank, they ask for a loan, in 3 days they want an answer, because they are unable to plan, because this is the network all over the world. I'm not telling this in Egypt. It's normal. It's normal. So we are already working this for what we can. If there are even developments, regulatory and technical developments, I think this could be beneficial for everybody. But definitely, I come also from a country, Italy, where SMEs are dominating our economy. So we need to work to be as close as possible to SMEs if we want really allow them to grow and to contribute to the GDP growth and employment, because we know how much they contribute to the employment of Egypt or Italy.
Yeah, I see. As you know, there is a very, very strong correlation between SMEs and financial inclusion. And let us talk a little bit about financial inclusion. As you know, banks have an essential role in their financial inclusion. What are the main activities banks should deploy to reach this objective? And let me touch a little bit about the digital infrastructure. How can digital services play in increasing access to financial services from your point of view?
When you talk about financial inclusion, I always refer to aspects of the team, because one team is definitely the onboarding of unbanked population, but the other is to work to make the banked population to rely more on banks. And this I refer to the what I said before, the extremely low percentage of loan to the GDP. I don't think it's due to the fact that banks are not willing to lend. I see more a problem of demand for many reasons, and one of the reasons definitely is the level of trust. Other reasons that have been, let's say, mentioned, or even including the high level of interest rate, I don't think that are real, because we always have to think at the real rate, not the nominal rate. Even when we had the interest rate at 25%, but with the inflation rate at 20, the real rate was 5. So this is not the real problem. I think that definitely, so financial inclusion for what we can means to support as much as possible the already banked population, including, I repeat, MSMEs, because this is the one, and definitely also to onboard unbanked people, to give them more chance, first of all, and also, let's say, aliment the electronic payments in order to, let's say, reduce the cash circulation that is a reason of many, many problems, and make anyway the system totally inefficient, because handling cash is extremely, extremely expensive for banks, for the central bank, and even for the company themselves. So I am amazed, to be honest, and this is an example I use when you know, I had to answer to some question, sometime even silly, from Italian or European friends that talking about how is in Egypt the situation, the security. There is no other country in the world I've seen that people can go with plastic bags of money, because the level of cash is so high, but also it means that they feel secure. Nobody would go with bags of cash in the streets in the States or in Europe. No, so this is also something that must be said. No, but definitely the way to allow the onboarding of more people to the banking sector is the digital services, because onboard this customer can be extremely expensive if you don't rely on digital services. So definitely I welcome, and we are very active participants in all the initiative to use electronic means. For example, electronic wallet, I believe is something that could work very well. And I understand very recently the central bank has launched a plan to facilitate the deployment of POS and other tools to facilitate the payment, electronic payment. All banks are working on a plan related to the financial inclusion, and all banks have created specific teams to work on the financial inclusion. So is a strong effort that we have to produce. Definitely banks have an important role in this. We need to also here to work in simplifying the language. We need to work on also tutorial to make people feeling safe using the electronic tools. For example, we did something very simple that we see is very successful. We put a phone next in our branches next to the ATMs. So the customer that has problem using the ATM can take the phone without even putting a name, because immediately on the other side, there is somebody from the contact center can drive the customer in using the ATM if he needs. So we need to find ways to make comfortable the customers to use the tools that we give to them. We can work in producing tutorial in order to allow people to let's say better cope with the new needs. I know that the central bank is also working on a project in order to allow the online KYC, and this would facilitate the onboarding of new customers, because there are people, for them it's a problem to go to the bank. So if they can do this in a different way, it could help. I think that the central bank is very clear how to address the problem, and the central bank knows that can count on the commitment of the Egyptian bank to support this path. And digital services here is very important, because we need to keep very cheap the cost of the services that we provide to this new kind of people. So digital services are very important, because they can get immediately directly to the customer, but also can allow banks to provide services at cheaper cost. And the new infrastructure, EBC, that has been created, so it's another example of the accelerated pace of the development of the local financial sector, that really is moving at a so fast pace. And really, banks are really striving to keep the pace of all these news. But we know that we have to do this, and faster we are, and better is for our economy.
Great. Digital services, e-commerce, this is my next question. You know, Alex Bank is doing some good initiatives and partnerships to support a number of affected industries through the e-commerce. Can you talk about the main objectives of implementing the strategic partnership, for instance, with Sawira Social Development Foundation, and also I remember Jumia? Would you Tell us a little bit about this.
Yeah, definitely. You know, already a few years ago, Alex Bank in the logic to pass from, let's say, CSR to CSV, creating shared value, has launched this initiative dedicated to Egyptian artisan. And definitely this started, I would say, from my discovery of the beauty of the production that we can find in Egypt. And to be honest, this started from Tunis Village, from the pottery of Tunis Village. And everything started from that. And we start thinking that perhaps we can help these artisans that are all across Egypt to, let's say, access better the market, to improve the production, to meet the market taste. And knowing that there are production that you have to leave like they are, because, for example, pottery of Tunisia, you cannot change the tradition, but there are other production that you can help with design and so on and so on, that can maintain the tradition. I think, for example, the alabaster in Luxor, no? But adding element of design and so on. So we created this Dummy Master, and today we have thousands of artisans that are under this platform. And you know, we organize also participation to fair for them in order to help them to sell. We brought last year, the last 2 years, even to Italy at the Artigiani Fiera. But then when erupted the COVID crisis, we realized that basically the market was dead, was closed. They could not sell. So, and this is also an example of how quickly we can react. We start discussing with Jumia, and the top manager of Jumia was quite responsive immediately, because I mean, everybody realized that this is something that could be very good. It is a positive message in a moment like this of continuity. And then also with the support of Savini Foundation, that immediately were on board, we basically created this branded store in Jumia that is populating. I can tell you that this is already involving 3,700 artisans that can sell their product through this platform. They are from 22 governorates. And by today, there will be there already 840 product, but we are adding product. And we are doing this also with implementing partners like Yadueya and Fairtrade Egypt, that are supporting the artisan in creating the proper product, following the quality. And thanks also to the strong support of Jumia, we have created a chain. For example, we have to consider that given the situation, when the product are received from the producer and before being packed, they are sanitized. Then after the packing, the last part is sanitized again by Jumia. So there are complexity that we have addressed in this, but we are very happy, because we don't have started yet the actual marketing that we start in the next day, but already sales have started, and we are all confident that this will bring very good to this artisan. And I would say that bring justice, because really the production are very, very good. There are traditions that are amazing. For example, the embroidery of Sinai, I love it. They do fantastic things, and I think this could be element that can be used in many, many production, even high-end production in Europe. So we are working on this due to the COVID, but it's something that we had already in mind. I am telling you that tomorrow I have a call with the organization in Italy, because I am really thinking how we could bring this abroad. My dream is that this is today a domestic platform, but really we'd like to find a way that also from Europe, people can purchase online this product. So we are, this is a dream. I don't know if we can let's say reach this dream, but you know, there is nothing better than keep dreaming, to keep very active and happy. So hopefully there will be a next stage, but for the time being, we are very happy of setting up of this brand store with Jumia, and I'm very thankful to all the partners that are with us. And I know that there are other partners that will join to really give the chance to Egyptian to buy Egyptian products and to Egyptian artisan to propose their valuable products.
Okay, let me, I have only two questions left. I want you to say something to the youth. What would you tell the junior bankers in Egypt?
The junior banker in Egypt, I would tell, well, I would remind them what I said before regarding the leadership, because my message to them is that they have a huge possibility because of the market dynamics that and a sector that is in expansion. Consider that in Europe, for example, the sector is losing jobs over jobs every year. It's not the case of Egypt. So young bankers in Egypt, they have really a lot of opportunities, and they can think positively to their career. They have to, let's say, learn. Sometimes they need to be patient, because it's important to consolidate the knowledge. I would suggest that, for example, being also, I would say, ambition. I would say them that ambition is a good thing, but I would look at an ambition that is not totally, let's say, personal, but always to think a collective ambition. I will tell them that also our profession is not only made of technical skills, but is made of integrity, is made of commitment, is made of responsibility. And I would like to remind them that the logic of corporate social responsibility is not only related or applied in the CSR department. I always say to my people that in anything we do, there is a component of social responsibility, because let's say the impact that our answer, yes or no, for example, to a financing company, can have on the life of the company, of workers, is huge. So we need to learn to be strong technically, to be able to take the right decision, and to take the decision in a fair way, in a transparent way, and remembering that the high sense of responsibility is needed. But I would like also to tell them that in applying this principle, they can be really proud that they will be able to contribute to development of their country.
Okay, my last question is, tell us something about Dante Campioni that is not related to business.
What I have to say?
For instance, tell us a little bit about your hobbies. What would you do if you have a spare day? Hypothetically, if you have a spare day, what would you do?
That's a good point, because spare day is not so easy. But I would say that I will contextualize to the current situation of being quarantined already for three months. So if and I want to do, I won't do, not because I have time, but because it's not time now. But one of the things, first thing I want to do when I can go around more, let's say, easily and with time, you know, I want to go to Cancalliri. Why? First of all, because I need to stay with people, first of all. And I need the warmth of Egyptian people. You can't imagine the kindness that I receive, because people understand I'm not Egyptian, and they ask me where I'm from. I'm from Italy. Ah, Italy, welcome, welcome, welcome. So I need these things. So it's, it's a personal thing. But also because I love the architecture of old Cairo. I think it's amazing. There is a lot of history there. I mean, what is called Moed Street, I think, if I remember. It's full of amazing expression of architecture. Or the Citadel, for example, is amazing. So really, after this period, I am not thinking to go to Red Sea, or I really want to melt with Cairo, you know, old Cairo. I need this. I need the warmth. I need some human contact, you know. So, and in a surrounding like old Cairo, that I repeat, I find the architecture that is so beautiful. So nothing major, you know, something that but good for the spirit.
Great. Mr. Denti, thank you very much for your time. Thank you very much for all the information, aspirations that you just shared with us. I'm quite confident that people will be will find it very beneficial to watch this episode of EBI Talks, and we're looking forward to meet you in person, inshallah, after this quarantine is ended. Stay safe, and all greetings to our colleagues in the bank. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you to you. It was a real pleasure. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Stay safe.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.